Pat Benatar and Lionel Richie. And for the first time anywhere in the world, we'll show you Michael Jackson's Pepsi commercial.
I'll do it. We gotta do it.
We were in that bar, the Hard Rock Cafe. It's called a scouting trip in the world of film. But I wanted Michael to come along because the areas were so dangerous. And Michael walked in, and some old drunken lady I saw and said, "And Michael Jack, Michael!" And being the hero he is, got off that stool and came to him, followed by maybe 20, 25 people, one by one. "Mike, Jack, Michael, oh, Mike!" And that kind of thing. "And Jack, hey, Jack, whoa, what?" And before you know it, everybody was there. And here we were, the eight of us, looking like this. Michael never moved. It was an interesting experience for Michael. But the experience turned out to be a nice experience because all they wanted to do was feel and touch and see a superstar. And they reached out and touched him, and Michael touched him back. And it was the first time that I saw some sort of mystical thing happening between him and people. And it was a nice, what was a scary moment turned out to be a nice moment, you know?
How many days of shooting to do Beat It?
Two nights. They weren't considered days. Long, hard nights. And somewhere around 3 o'clock in the morning, you question whether you even want to stay any longer, but you stay, and you get it.
And then editing?
Oh, editing was a 2 weeks or so, but editing process is so difficult with adding music and sound effects and all. I mean, I'm excited about the fact that it was one of the first videos that used the track and had sound. I mean, it would not be anywhere near as exciting as those doors in the factory, you know.
Beat it, beat it, beat it, beat it,
if the fight scene in Beat It seems remarkably real, it's because Giraldi didn't only use actors. He added actual street gangs as extras.
And that was the most amazing experience that I've had in filmmaking. Because Michael Jackson, Michael Peters, Vincent Patterson, me and the cameras, dancers, and all of these street gangs are watching, and before you know it, the first time we do it, pop, the top, boom, dancing, they don't usually dance, but they saw something happening in their brothers, and I know in their bodies and their minds, they said to themselves, "Now that's macho. Now we may be tough, you know, we may take your eyes off, but we can't dance like that." And the more they danced, and by the 10th take, the thing was so hot. Everybody came from everywhere, and I never forget the smoke in that factory, you know, in that warehouse, and those doors opening. I mean, it was really hot, and there was not one bit of trouble.
Finished, and you and Michael were looking at it together. Did you or Michael know you had a winner on your hands?
Yes. I mean, I can't. You can be humble and say, but you know what? It's hot. Mm-hmm. Michael Peters had a party, the choreographer had a party two nights later, and I was in Los Angeles. And I took the cassette. I went to a party, which is predominantly black, and played it. And the party was in one room, the dancing was in one room, and everybody stayed in that room, and they must have played it 75 times. And we knew, I mean, you can know, you know, damn, you know, whoa, one more time, you know, I mean, it's hot, you know, we're at a time when things like that have a great appeal, and that has a good appeal.
Incredible impact that Beat It had. Were you a bit disappointed when you found out that Michael Jackson had chosen John Landis to do Thriller?
Mm-hmm. I think all creative people who have egos would be disappointed, but I think the choice to choose John for that kind of piece that he had experience in Werewolf, and he's a fine, fine major league director, and I think their collaboration is wonderful.
Beat It, directed by you, Thriller by Landis, both had these dramatic manhole scenes.
The manhole scenes are Michael's. That was one of the scenes, and in Beat It, he suggested, he always wanted to do that. In fact, he bothered me, he said, "Bob, when are we doing the manhole?" you know, I kept looking for, you know, manhole's not that easy to find, especially ones you can go down with a schedule out tight. But we found it and did it, and that might end up being his trademark. He may do Peter Pan and have a manhole scene, I don't know, but effective scenes, you know?
Come on. Come on, attitude.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Drink it up. Let me help you with that, my friend.
I wanted to work with someone that Michael would be comfortable with. You know, because sometimes you can get a brainwave and think, so-and-so would be great. Fellini, wow. Yeah. Now he would be good. But I mean, you can think, and you get him, and he agrees to do it. But some of the chemistry can go wrong. So I knew Bob had worked with Michael. Bob Giraldi, who directed it, had worked with Michael. And so I thought, and I liked his work. I wanted to work with him. So it seemed to fit, yeah. He came over and he had this feeling of Michael and I working together, which is kind of a free feeling. He wanted to communicate this sort of freedom of, like, you know, easy rider, you know, get out.
Say what you want, but don't play games with my affection. Take what you need, but don't leave me with no direction.
Did the say video cost $300,000?
Ouch. Why would I? Well, I don't want to talk about money less. I mean, it cost around that. Film is expensive. I know that young people that give you tapes and all would suggest that maybe it doesn't have to be quite as expensive as it is. But I am around a lot of, you know, kind of cameramen and the prop people and whatever. My film costs close to $100,000 a day, unless there's a good reason for not. And Paul and Michael are superstars. We have to do things right. I think the video suggests that it's an expensive video. I think it's I'm getting around that subject as best I can, because that's not really for me to. I don't want to disclose.
But
it's not my.
It's in the press. I mean, it's in Time Magazine.
It's close.
It's in every newspaper.
It's close.
I mean,
it's probably a little more.
More than 300.
Who said that?
First time you've ever admitted that, you know. Forget the money. Okay, fine. You spent $327,000. But here you are on the set. You have these two superstars, Michael Jackson and Paul McCartney, and let's don't leave out Bob Giraldi. There's three pretty large egos. How was that?
It's phenomenal. I mean, that's an incredible experience. Paul has his camper and his entourage, and Michael has his camper and his entourage, and I have my camper and my entourage. And we came together beautifully. I've since made a statement in the press, which I don't think anybody was too pleased with, because it always gets edited in the press, I hope, you know, that there's only one star in my set. Meaning that when time comes to work, right, there's no stars and no star catering. They do their job, they do their jobs, I do mine, mm-hmm. And it's all business. By the way, I think one of the magical moments is when Paul puts shaving cream on Michael's face, and Michael didn't know that was coming. That was when Paul and I went over to the side and said, on this take, why don't you try just going right across your face and go under him and see what happens. And Mike, the expression on Michael's face is so genuine, you know, one of those magic moments.
You can never say. Following in the footsteps of Alfred Hitchcock, Giraldi turned up as a character in his own video.
Actually, that was a fun scene because I've never really been a performer before, and I'm watching the monitor to see the way it's going. And finally, they all said, Bob, relax, don't watch the monitor, do what you do, and we'll take care of it. There really were no tough scenes. The crowd control was good. Michael and Paul were wonderful. The toughest scene actually was the last scene. It was going away because we were fighting. Anytime you fight the sunset light, you see, it's tough. Get dressed, come on, get Michael out of the camper with the tuxedo on. Paul's Paul ready? No, they're doing it. Linda, no, Linda's hair. You know, I mean, all those things are part of the process of making film. Let's go, the sun is dumping. I have 20 minutes left, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
I loved it, you know. And he's a great director, Bob. You know, he just tells you what to do, and you just get on with it.
I woke up about 3 weeks later and realized that I had just finished working with the musical history of Yesterday, Today, and Tomorrow. And that's exactly how I feel.
Are you difficult to work with?
I guess so. I guess so. But you know what? I asked Michael, Paul, Lionel. I'm difficult. Every star and every director have a relationship, and depending on what happens, and you can't be friends with everybody. I know what I want. I'm decisive and quick, and sometimes I'm offensive, I guess, and not tolerant enough of people's feelings. I mean, I am the captain of a ship that has 150 people around. I can't make excuses. Yes, I'm difficult, but there's not a good director alive, or even a weak director alive, who's not difficult to work for. The process of making film is very difficult, and it gets harder and harder and harder when you work with the bigger stars. It doesn't get easier. It looks magical, because that's why they are superstars. But to get it all together and put and do it is difficult.
So now you're the master of two farms, music, video, and commercials. And you get a chance to put them both together now in a Pepsi commercial with Michael Jackson doing Billie Jean. And it was that commercial, for reasons you couldn't possibly predict, that would put your name on the front pages of newspapers all over the world. Things had really been going well up until that point. In fact, you had one version of the commercial in the can. What are we going to see here? What's this first one about?
The street commercial for Pepsi-Cola was a wonderful experience, featuring Michael and the Jacksons, the brothers, and a wonderful, wonderful talent, the star of Tap Dance Kid, Alfonso Ribeiro. And he plays an imitator of Michael. Pepsi lyrics are set to Billie Jean, the tune of Billie Jean, and there's some Jacksons hanging around. Actually, I really shouldn't preempt the commercial. Don't be too smart. I'll let you see. Michael Jackson has developed this wonderful new glove. I don't know if it's right hand or left hand. Sometimes I think it's left hand. And he was wearing it in the concert commercial. And he was in my dressing room getting ready with some of the brothers to go on to do one of the scenes. And we were, come on, Michael, let's go. We're late. And he said, he was all dressed up in his wonderful outfit, the same outfit he wore in the wonderful Motown special. And he said, wait a minute, I have to go to the bathroom place. I'll be right with you. So we said, okay, we waited. And he went into my bathroom, closed the door. And our heart fell. We thought maybe some groupie had you know, kind of like stowed away in the bathroom. We ran to the bathroom, opened it up. And in fact, what he did was drop the glove in the toilet.
Before or after?
I don't know. And we all ran around crazy looking for a hanger. And it was Michael who looked at us and he picked up the glove himself. And it was wonderful. It was wonderful, you know? And we cleaned it off and the glove went on to be famous.
There's the street commercial and then there's the concert commercial, as you've titled it, which is where the accident occurred. What's the storyline of the concert commercial?
The storyline of the concert commercial is that the Jacksons are at a concert, attended by about 5,000 screaming, idolizing young
people. Did you have a live audience there?
Yes. Mm-hmm. We had a live audience of 5,000 people, approximately.
The camera's rolling. It's January the 27th. What happened?
We filmed the commercial.
The accident.
You're asking me about the accident.
Of course.
Well, the accident is something that I really can't talk about too much, obviously, because it's very highly technical and still in the minds of people, and for a lot of reasons, and I won't talk about it. I could tell you what I saw, because it's, you know, an experience that brought together a lot of people, too, that tried to help. Michael was supposed to go and did go to the top of the stairs. The Jacksons run out on stage, and there's a sort of dramatic entrance for Michael to come downstairs and to join his brothers in singing the final lyrics of the Pepsi song. And 5,000 screaming young people adore that. Now, I had five cameras going at that because you can't do that many times, and there's a lot of things to film. And I was in the wings, stage right of the setting, and I had five black and white monitors that reflect the cameras that I have. We had done takes in the morning, and we'd done some takes in the afternoon, and it's been reported that this was the last take. That's just dramatic. It wasn't supposed to be the last take. And Michael was situated up there, and I saw him dance down the stairs, and in black and white monitors, I could not tell that his hair caught fire. And it wasn't until I saw everybody rush him on the black and white monitors that I knew something was wrong. I thought maybe somebody had come from the stage, from the audience, the way a lot of people do sometimes, and his bodyguards and people ran out. And then they said that his hair caught fire and we ran out. But there was terrific control. The audience did not go crazy. They were obviously concerned for Michael. Michael was very brave. film later has shown me that his hair caught on fire and he came down, and while it was burning, he was trying to get his jacket off. So I think he thought it was initially his jacket on fire, and only because he's so incredibly talented, he did two quick spins, and the fire seemed to go out by his own force. Now that film obviously is, you know, in protection of everybody. A case like this is always, you know, a case that nobody likes, you know, likes to talk about. But the accident happened. He was taken to the hospital. We saw him later, and you know, I guess history will show that he's on his way to recovery, and he's made some appearances, and he's very brave, and it was unfortunate, but that's what happened.
Time magazine said that you had already, or Michael had already done four takes of the fireworks shot, but you weren't quite satisfied. Time said you ordered a fifth take and asked that the fireworks be heated up and that Michael walk more slowly in front of them. Is Time magazine's account true?
Well, Time magazine also quoted me as saying some things that were not true either, so I don't really. Less for me to, and I really don't want to skirt the issue. I would love to sit here and give you my opinion, as certainly Michael would and other people who were involved in this traumatic experience would like to give their opinion. It just does anybody no good for me to comment on what Time or Newsweek or what Michael's bodyguard as a spokesman has claimed or whatever. People have their own feelings, and thank the Lord that he was not injured beyond what happened, and he is a, you know, an overwhelming favorite of young people today, and he can go on to, I hope, to do his, you know, do his beautiful work. I don't want to be evasive, but to talk about that would be silly. And that's not really the base, you know.
For the first time anywhere in the world, this is Michael Jackson's Pepsi commercial.
You're a whole new generation. You're dancing through the day. You're loving what to do. I put a Pepsi in the motion. But that choice is up to you. Hey, you're the Pepsi generation.
Do you think you'll be working with him again?
Oh, I don't know. I think we've done a lot of great work together in the early pioneer stages of music videos. I think that he'll, I don't know, I can't speak for Michael Jackson. I'd love to work with Michael Jackson anytime because he's a great talent.